Great. So let's build on our discussion about our standard errors and stuff. So we're looking at hypothesis testing, right? So our standard errors, they can actually be used to perform hypothesis testing on the coefficients. So yeah, hypothesis testing on the coefficients. Coefficients. Cool. So the most common hypothesis test involves testing the null hypothesis of. So here we're saying, okay, this is the null hypothesis is good. If you do not know anything about hypothesis testing, I would say pick up a statistics book and try understand the hypothesis testing before watching this video, because we're going to just skip through some of the principles of hypothesis testing. Hypothesis testing says H naught, so that's going to be our null hypothesis. There is no relationship between X and Y. That is the most common hypothesis testing versus the alternative, which says H1 or H1, the alternative hypothesis test, there is a relationship between X and Y. So we can use our standard errors to do this hypothesis test. So mathematically, what does that mean? Because here we have written it in words, but mathematically, what are we trying to say here? Mathematically, what we're doing is just doing this test. H naught, we H naught say there is no relationship. It means, remember we've written our equation like this. Beta 1x, let's just say plus the error term, right? Plus the error term. And if you want, you can use the prediction one like this. We had written it like that, right? So if there's no relationship, it means this beta 1, it has to be 0. Also, yeah, it has to be 0 to show that there's actually no relationship here between x and y. Because if it is any value, it means if this is 2, 3, it means there's actually a relationship. Y is equal to something plus 3x. There's a relationship. So it means beta 1 needs to be 0, right? So it means if I say there's no relationship, it means my beta 1 is equal to 0. There's no relationship. X disappears. No matter what X is going to be, it's going to be neutralized by this 0. Or you've increased TV budget by 10,000. Ha, good luck, because this beta 1 is going to make it 0. The effect is going to be 0. We do not care. There is no relationship. So my beta 1 is going to be 0, right? And then, so the alternative that says there is actually a relationship, it means my beta 1 is not equal to 0. That's what it basically means. Beta 1 is not equal to 0. And if you want to get into the whole theory of hypothesis testing and stuff, this is the two-sided hypothesis test. You can do that on, you can go through the whole theory of hypothesis testing, but that's not exactly what we're doing here, right? Then, to test the null hypothesis, to see if it is true, we need to determine whether this beta 1 estimate, the estimate of beta 1, is sufficiently far from zero. We need to know if our estimate for beta 1 is it sufficiently far from zero that we can be confident that beta 1 is non-zero, right? If this one is very, very far from zero, because this is our estimate of z, this is our estimate of what? Of the actual beta 1. So if this is very, very large or in the very, very negative zone there, then we might say, yeah, this is sufficient. My estimate of beta 1 is sufficiently far from zero. So which means my beta 1 cannot be zero. We want it to be sufficiently far from zero, right? But then someone might say, okay, what does that mean to be sufficiently far from zero? What does that mean? How far is far enough? Far from zero. How far is sufficiently far from zero, right? Now, this depends on the accuracy of beta 1, right? Because why does it depend on the accuracy of beta 1? If I know that my estimate for beta 1 is very, very accurate, is a very, very accurate estimator of beta 1, of the true beta 1, it means if this one moves to say, so this is zero. if I know that my estimate for beta 1 is very, very close to the true value, it means if this estimate is equal to 5, then I'm very confident because I know that my estimate is accurate. It's very accurate. I know that my beta 1 is somewhere very close to this 5 as well, because my estimate was accurate, right? And if some couple of videos ago, is it like 2 videos ago, how do you measure accuracy of an estimate, of a coefficient estimate? We measure it using the SE, if you remember well, right? So the sufficiently far enough depends on my accuracy. If I'm very accurate, it means if my beta estimate here is far, then it means also my real value is far, because those two are almost equal, right? And them being equal, how do I measure them being equal? I use this. This is the one that tells me the accuracy, right? The standard error tells me the accuracy. If my standard error is small, if this standard error is small, then it means I'm very, very accurate. I'm very accurate. It means my beta 1, the estimate, is almost the same as my true beta 1. So which means any relatively small values of beta 1, they would show me that, your beta 1 also has a value, because they are very accurate, because my estimate has been accurate since my standard error is small, right? So it means if my beta 1 was, like, let's say 0.5, due to that accuracy, I would be like, dude, beta 1 is very close to 0.5 as well, because I know that my estimate has been very accurate, right? So this will provide, so my standard error being small, and then I see that my estimate is a value, it means that my beta 1 is not equal to 0. It's not equal to, it also has that's almost a similar value as my estimate here. So I will then reject this one, H naught, and I'll be like, nah, dude, H naught is wrong. Beta 1 is not equal to, the true beta 1 is not equal to 0. I'll then accept H1. I'll accept H1 and say, yes, my beta 1 is not equal to 0. And then, which will mean now that there is a relationship between X and Y. Right? Cool. So if my standard error of beta 1, if it is large, it means, yo, dude, your estimate of beta 1 is not even accurate. It's not equal to the true. It's not even accurate to the true one. In that case, it means this beta 1 here must be very, very large for me to even be happy for us to reject this, because we might be like, your standard error is wrong. My beta 1 is saying 100. My beta 1 is now saying 100, but I'm not confident that the true beta 1 is somewhere close here, because my standard error is large. Beta 1 could be somewhere there. My standard error is large, the difference between beta 1 and the beta 1 estimate and the true beta 1. My standard error is saying, dude, there's a large difference between these two. So even though my beta 1 estimate is saying it's 100, how confident can I be now that my true beta 1 is not 0? Maybe my true beta 1 is 0 and the 100, the difference here, the standard error, is large because of this difference here. You get what I mean? So a large standard error is not sufficient for us to reject H0. It is not sufficient, right? So now what you will do is what you can do now is, then you can use something called a t-statistic. If you want, you can just grab a statistics book. An introduction to statistics, it will tell you about t-statistics. T-statistic is beta, we calculate it as this for my beta 1. That is the equation of calculating the t-statistic. Don't worry, R spits out all these values for you. So this basically measures the number of standard deviations which is at the bottom here, the number of standard deviations that beta 1 is from 0. This is how beta 1 is from 0, dividing by the standard deviation just measures the number of standard deviations that beta 1 is from 0. So, what then usually happens is, if there is no relationship between x and y, then we expect this. If you're using the t-tables, you see the number of degrees of t-tables. When you do a bit of statistics, you see if there is no relationship between x and y, we expect this t-distribution to have n minus 2 degrees of freedom. And another fact is the t-distribution, it has a bell-shaped. You remember, if you remember the normal distribution, the t-distribution will have a bell-shaped for values of n greater than approximately like 30. When it gets to 30 and above, it will act as a normal distribution. It will be quite similar to the normal distribution. So what this then means is it is a matter of computing the probability observing any value equal to to the modulus of what do you call this? Modulus of that t that we are calculating here. Or larger. Assuming, and yeah, our assumption is, okay, we do not know where our beta 1, the true one, is, but we are just assuming that the beta 1 is equal to 0. So we are assuming that, okay, our beta 1 is equal to 0. What we just want to do is to see how far our beta 1 is. So basically, let me say that again. Imagine our t is just calculating the number of standard deviations between our beta 1 estimate and our true beta 1. So what we can do is we can force this equal to 0. If that is equal to 0, let's now calculate how far, when we bring it down to 0, let's calculate how far our beta 1 is from that 0, right? And that probability that we would have calculated there is what is called the p-value. So the p-value measures this that probability. It measures that probability that we talked about. Like, consequently, we need to compute the probability observing any value equal to t or larger. So when it's a normal distribution like this, right? Basically, what we've done is, let's say my true beta was here, and then my beta one was there. I'm just putting, it's not going to be like this, but this is just for illustrative purposes. We bring down our beta naught, our true beta to 1, thereby also dragging our beta that side. So we are going to have a situation where our beta 1, the true one, is there, and then this estimate has been pulled there. So what we are calculating when we say with our t, we've made our beta 1, the true one, equal to 0. So we're calculating a t statistic that is like this. And we want to calculate the probability that this t statistic, probability of observing a value equal to this t or greater. So we are basically trying to calculate, it's at the tail end here. It's at the tail ends. Can we observe anything at the tail end? Can we observe any value at the tail end? I don't want to get into like the t distribution and stuff like that. You can look at a stats book, but I assure you, R gives you these calculations. So basically what it means is, if the probability of observing values here is large, if it is large like this, Or there's going to be a situation, let me not say if, because I'm going to explain there now. There's going to be a situation where it's at the very, very tail end there. Tail end there. Very, very small values. So you can either observe large values or small values, right? And this probability that would have calculated is what is called the p-value, right? That is a p-value. And a small p-value like this indicates that it is unlikely to observe such a substantial association between predictor and response due to chance, right? Due to chance. In the absence of any real association between the predictor. So it means if my p-value is small, R is going to spit out the p-value. If my p-value is very small, chances are very, very high that there's a relationship. That's what it's basically saying. Chances are very, very high that there is a relationship. So hence, when we see a p-value, we reject the null hypothesis, this one here, that there's no relationship. If the p-value is small enough, if the p-value is very, very small, we reject H0 and then we accept H1. We accept H1, right? Usually, the cutoff point is 5%. Excuse me, 5% or 1%. That is usually the cutoff point for rejecting for the p-value. It needs to be 5% or 1%. When n equal to 30, this corresponds to a t statistic of around 2 and 2.75. R spits out this value. You just have to make a decision, right? Let me delete this and then just show you what R will spit out. When you run this in R, you are going to get a table similar to this. It will say the intercept, which is our beta naught, and then my t, and then the TV variable there, right? It's going to spit out like a table like this. And it's going to say, okay, the coefficient for the intercept, which is that beta naught itself, it's going to say maybe 0.7.0325. And what is the coefficient for the TV? It's going to give you the beta one. It's going to be 0.75, like that. 0.0475. And then it will spit out the standard error. I will tell you what the standard error is. I'm going to say, okay, the standard error is 0.4578. That is the standard error of beta naught. And the standard error for beta 1 is this one here. Very accurate. Very, very accurate. And then it's going to give you a t statistic. I will give you a t statistic. It's going to say maybe the t statistic is 15.36. And then for beta 1, it's going to be 70.67, and here it's going to give you maybe the p-value, and p-value will say greater than less than 0.00001, less than 0.00001, right? So how do you interpret this table? So this table shows the least squares model for regression of the number of units sold on TV advertising budget from advertising data, right? So the coefficients for beta naught and beta 1 are very large relative to their standard errors. So this t statistic, you remember our t statistics was saying, let's say for beta 1, it was beta 1 minus 0 over standard error of beta 1. You remember? So this t statistic here, if I have my beta 1, which is very large compared to my standard error, it means my t statistic is going to be very large as well. Since my t statistics are very large, the probabilities of seeing such values, if H0 is true, is virtually zero. Basically, it means that our H0 is not true. We're not going to choose our H0. We're going to choose our H1. This situation happens when our H1 is true, right? Yet we conclude that beta 1 is not equal to zero. Yeah, of course, beta 0 is, okay, we conclude that we do a hypothesis test for beta 0. We see the t statistic very, very large. Ah, so beta naught is not equal to zero. We do the hypothesis test for beta one, and then we see t statistic is very large. So beta 1 is not equal to zero. So for both cases, we accept the H1 for both cases, right? We accept the, and we reject their respective H0s, right? Cool. So We can also look at the p-value. The small p-value for the intercept, this one here, indicates that we reject the null hypothesis that beta naught is equal to zero. And the small p-value for TV indicates that we reject the null hypothesis that beta 1 is equal to zero. Thus, we accept that there is a relationship between TV and sales. Rejecting beta naught is equal to zero means that we conclude that in the absence of TV expenditure, sales are non-zero. Because for beta naught, we have this as the H naught and this as the H1. My H1 is going to be like this, right? Yeah, not equal to zero. So this, interpreting this, it means my beta naught, remember what my beta naught is. Beta naught is sales without TV advertising, right? That is my beta naught, if you remember well. So here, this H naught is basically saying the sales without TV advertising is equal to zero. And my H1 is saying the sales without TV advertising is not equal to zero. It means there are sales even if we do not have TV advertising. The p-value for my beta naught here showed that beta naught is actually significant. It's a significant factor in our model because my p-value is very small. Since my p-value is very small, beta naught is very significant. It means we reject the first part. We're like, nope, we reject you because my p-value is very small. So which means we are accepting this one here that says sales without TV advertising are not equal to zero, which means there are some sales without TV advertising. That is the interpretation. So what I've come across is many people build their models but do not know how to interpret them. This is an example of how you interpret when you see all those p-values and stuff like that. This is what it's actually telling you. It's telling you that in our case, there are going to be sales without TV advertising. That's what that is the question that your executives will be interested in. So cool. Now that we've done that technical part, in the next video we are going to move on to assess the accuracy of the whole model itself. We've assessed the accuracy of these individual coefficients. Now the whole model itself, when we put together all these coefficients, how accurate is it going to be? That is going to be in the next video.